Good evening, voters. In just a few days, the finance minister will present his budget for the next financial year. This is the last big full year budget that this government will present before we go into the next election. So it becomes extremely crucial to see what the government plans, what the government's vision will be. Now, here is the scenario. In our country, less than 2% people pay taxes. Less than 2% of the citizens are actually taxpayers who are building towards all of that revenues that the government is taking. In our country, in the last 1 year, 76% of the total wealth that was generated, the total prosperity that came to our country, 76% of that went to just 1% of the rich in our country. The 50% poorest of our country just got 1% increase in their wealth. That's it. That is the disparity. So tonight we just want to sit and discuss whether this is the right time to bring in taxes for the super rich, whether it's the wealth tax, inheritance tax, whether it's taxing their long-term capital gains, all this money that they are making as the census is conquering new peaks every day, or whether it is the super rich tax. We discuss all of that after this short report.
Papers to be laid on the table. Sri Arun Jaitley ji.
Madam Speaker, I rise to lay on the table a copy.
Finance Minister Arun Jaitley today tabled the Economic Survey 2018 in the Parliament. The survey estimates that the Indian economy will grow by 7 to 7.5% in 2018-2019, thereby reinstating India as the world's fastest growing major economy. While the report points out that there has been a 50% increase in the number of indirect taxpayers under the GST regime, there is little indication on what an individual taxpayer can expect. A recent report by Oxfam states that 73% of the wealth generated last year went only to the richest 1% of our country, while the 50% poorest of the people struggled to survive and got just 1% increase in wealth. The report also says that the economic gap can also be reduced by taxing the super rich, by reintroducing inheritance tax, increasing wealth tax, reducing and eventually doing away with corporate tax breaks. So tonight, let us debate the options in front of Finance Minister Arun Jaitley. In his last full budget before the next polls, should he take the bold steps needed to bring in more money? The debate begins now.
So here are our three simple questions that we are going to ask our panelists tonight. Should there be a higher tax on the wealthiest in our country? What is also termed as the super rich tax? Should we increase that for the top 1%? Or more, that depends on the finance minister. Now you may see the other side bringing the argument, but there's already a surcharge. Should there be more than that as they return back to the rest of the country? Question number two, are tax structures designed in a way to benefit only a specific segment of our society? Are tax structures designed in a way that those who are already wealthy are minting more money, but those who are actually in need of it end up carrying the burden for the rest of the country? And question number three, is there a way that the finance minister can actually widen the tax base? How can he ensure that more than 2% of our country ends up paying income tax? Let's say good evening to our guests. I've got Mr. Mohan Guruswamy, economist, who's regularly a part of our debates on Mirror Now. Thank you, Mr. Guruswamy, for joining us. Representing the BJP, I've got Gopal Krishna Agarwal. He's the national spokesperson for economic affairs of the BJP. Mr. Guruswamy, let me come to you first and ask what your view is. Should there be a higher tax when it comes to the wealthiest, or the super rich of our country?
I'd like to see more tax collection. The tax GDP ratio today in India is 16.7, and out of that, half is from direct taxes, which is about 9 odd lakh crores. You need to collect more. You need to collect with a wider net, and you also need to make some people pay more. And there are lots of areas which taxation could be brought. For instance, you know, there is talk of discussions about a tax on property. That's even which people own, there's a tax on land, and, you know, various things. You've got to mop up wealth, because otherwise you won't have any money to redistribute to people who need it more. Redistribute means reinvest, invest it in people who need it more. So I think there is a case for more stringent taxation, more taxation, to achieve more taxation in general. And we need to get that ratio up from 16.7 to closer to 20 if we want to be able to do any good.
Mr. Guruswamy, even a few years ago when we got rid of the inheritance tax, the logic that was given to us was that the cost of collecting that tax doesn't justify the amount that's coming in. But here are the larger optics and the concept of it, which is to say that there has to be some balance in the society. Now, there's a report that just come out by Oxfam that suggests that 76% of the wealth that was generated last year only went to 1% of our country. The rest didn't really prosper the way that 1% did. And so there is a huge gap already. Is taxes a way of ensuring there is at least some narrowing of that gap, whether it is inheritance tax, wealth tax, you know, people who have so much money that they're minting even more out of the stock market rally? Should we not be taxing them in terms of a long-term capital gains tax then?
Absolutely. I think there's a case for capital gains tax on stocks and shares, increasing that. Case for property taxes, case for, you know, inheritance tax. I think you need to get these taxes back, because, you know, this you need to get more money in the government's kitty. Today, 95% of the budget is chiseled out in stone. There's nothing you can do. Your interest and, you know, defense and all that takes away 95% of the budget. And your capital expenditure in the budget is only about 9%. You need to get it. Where are you going to get the money from? You're afraid to remove subsidies. You're afraid to cut down public sector losses. You're afraid to do so many things, and you're stuck. You don't have money to create capital expenditure, to create jobs, to build new infrastructure, all that you need. Arvind Subramanian spoke about requiring $4 to $5 trillion in the next 18 years. And, you know, so you really need to get working now.
Mr. Gopal Agarwal, very useful.
Mr. Jetli,
yes,
has probably done the proposals by now. Has his job worked out here?
He does. He absolutely does. Mr. Gopal Agarwal, where do you stand on this debate? Why should we not do it? Rather, is the government going to consider this? Because clearly, in the last 4 years, we've seen a bit of a surcharge come in for those who earn more than 1 crore, but that's about it.
Actually, what we have to look into, how the tax compliance is. The whole tax compliance is very skewed. Lot of many citizens of the country, though they have to pay tax, they are not paying because of the leakages and the non-establishment of audit trail.
Yeah.
With demonetization and GST, that audit trail has been established, and the tax compliance has definitely increased. The government is focusing on tax compliance, so that through GST and demonetization, more and more people who are bound to pay tax should pay tax. That compliance is extremely required, and we have seen in the economic survey, it clearly mentions that number of taxpayers with regard to indirect and direct tax has increased by 50%. And at the same time, the tax collection, direct tax collection, has also improved by 19%. Similarly, government expect that once GST is in place, indirect tax collection will also increase. So, though I agree there is an inequality in the income distribution in the country, but that's an historical fact that we have to look into. It's not because of some actions of the government, current government, that this skewed development is taking place. The second important aspect on this social security and distribution of subsidies, etc., is to block the leakages. The Jan Dhan account and direct benefit transfer have been successful in doing just this. Once these both mechanism of higher tax compliance, eliminating tax evasion, and plugging the leakages in the social security scheme, and targeted benefit distribution to the targeted persons are in place, there will be more resources with the government for distribution of social security or social benefits to the common man. Unless we put these both infrastructure in place, any amount of increase in tax rates or anything will not bring the result that we have seen over the years. Earlier, government had increased tax indiscriminately, but there was leakages in the social delivery mechanism. There was tax evasion. The current government has been successful on both this count, and I think this skewedness in concentration of wealth will be taken care of in future period.
But why can't you do both? Why can't you do both? Why can't you ensure that there is that you are plugging in the leakages, that you are cracking down on those who are evading tax, which is clearly a significant part of our country today, but also ensuring that those who are benefiting the most are able to contribute more towards nation building. People have so many platforms today, Mr. Agarwal. There is property, there is the stock market, where they're just cashing away their money. The general understanding amongst the working classes that we are the ones who are actually working for survival here. The rich get to get away, stash their money left, right and center, and they don't even have to pay taxes. How do you fix that perception?
No. The if you see the data in the current scenario, 95% of the small and medium firms are out of the GST network in tax compliance. They are contributing only 3,000 to 4,000 crores under GST. The government has given a lot of exemption to the small person. Only 4,000 companies, firms, top 4,000 firms are contributing 80% of the GST. This is the issue. In the direct tax also, only 24 lakh people are showing an income of more than 10 lakh. So that there is a problem is at a different level. Just simply increasing the tax rate will not solve the problem. People are paying taxes, but large portions of our population is out of the tax rate. And the whole business transaction, there is no audit trail. At present, there was leakages. Every individual is paying indirect tax, every small person, everybody. But that was not reaching to the government, that tax paid by individual was not reaching to the government coffers. So with GST in place, now there is an audit trail, and therefore government has been able to reduce indirect taxes. A reduction of indirect taxes benefits the common man. So it's not that simple that you are saying just simply increase the tax rate on the people who are already complying, who are already paying, and that will solve the problem. It is not that simple. Actually, government is tackling the whole problem through higher tax compliance, establishing audit trail, reducing indirect taxes.
Okay, I get all of that. Better delivery here of is social security. Control leakages.
And I,
Mr. Gopal Agarwal, do you believe
one,
or
one
not
example,
that this is also a way of doing
gains.
It? Yes. Go ahead. On what, on capital gains?
Yes, I agree with you that higher tax can be laid, but it is not the simple case in India. You were talking of capital gain. One thing I tell you about the earlier government was they used the mechanism of capital gain and security transaction tax to create hawala transactions, do PMLA transactions, evade taxes. So these are the corruption, black money. Ultimately, these are the issues that the government first should tackle them, then move on creating an higher slab. So first you have to create an ecosystem of tax compliance, ecosystem of transparency, ecosystem of delivery. Unless you do it, just simply increase the tax rate will not help.
Okay, Mr. Goswami, do you agree? Gopal Agarwal
right
seems
path.
To suggest that
creating in itself
that the environment where people who are already rich are managing to make some more money, but you're not even getting any tax out of it, is all right, because if you shift this, if you change it, then you're only opening up more avenues for corruption, for money laundering.
I don't agree.
There were mechanisms by which
for a start, you know, the plan was, or what?
Yes, Mr.
Gopal, let me speak now. You've spoken enough. Let me finish. Yeah. So the number of taxpayers have to go up. All that I agree. But you have to, what he has outlined is the creation of a kind of a police state. Are you going to go after people? I'll tell you this much. The mood of growth depends on, you know, the optimism of getting rich. And if you don't have that optimism, you won't invest. And so you've got to keep a public mood and an investor mood also up. You can't say that, you know, I'll whip you in the town square unless you pay taxes. That doesn't work. So you got to do taxes in terms of what is collectible. Now, I always say that property is visible. You can't hide property. There's circle rates on it. So values of property is unknown. There's a whole system on it. All central government doesn't get anything from that. State government doesn't get anything from that, except in terms of transfers of ownership. So you need to get some of those taxations back. You need to, there's a lot of vacant land, tax it, there's land, tax it, there's value. Industries have land, industries have buildings, they have offices. I think all that property, and you know, when the company is selling, today they're all making money by selling land. So why don't you tax it? I think, you know, if it's standing dormant and value is increasing, tax it. Raise more money. And if even if you add 1,000 rupees in our total housing stock, you'll get 1 lakh crores a year. And that's a lot of money. And I think you really got to think of easy pickables where people can't hide. What you do is, you know, you force people into misdirection, and then, you know, and what is obvious is not collected. For instance, you know, the number of Mercedes, Benzes and BMWs, you know who the owners are. Why aren't you collecting? Then, you know, you say that my system is corrupt and it's bad, and you know. So if the system, you got to factor in that into the system and say, okay, how will I increase revenues even more? You know, so I think a lot can be done. Simplifying procedures, going after what is visible and all that. But you cannot create a police state and say that, you know, I will use bank accounts, I will use Aadhaar, I will do this, I will do that, and I'll put them in jail. Then investment will slow down. Nobody wants to invest. You know, the wanting to get rich is the objective we should encourage. Encourage people to get rich so that you can collect more taxes. You know, government should see itself as a tax farmer. If wealth goes up, the revenues go up.
Right.
But if you do start, you know, blowing the whistle at every street corner, then you're not going to have wealth creation. And that is something which we're experiencing now. Why aren't people investing? Why aren't Indians investing in India? Now this, and a good part of the FDI which also comes into the country is Indian money. Ratan Tata once said, it's so difficult to do business here. It's impossible to do business here. Which is why the Tata Group, the biggest industrial house in the country, is more invested abroad than in India now. So you are driving out people by police state methods. You can't do that. This is a democratic country. You got to get voluntary compliance and inescapable compliance. That what is obvious, pick on it.
Right. Okay. Let me bring in.
Everybody knows who's doing fiddles on how on agriculture tax.
Yes. In fact, I want to talk about agricultural tax also.
You know, because that's. I heard one chief minister say.
Yes, Mr. Goswami, if I can just come back to you in just 2 minutes, I just want to go across to our callers and I'll come back to you on that point of agricultural tax as well. I have in fact got Vishnu calling us from Pune. Good evening, Vishnu. Where do you stand on this debate? Just a few days to go for Mr. Jaitley to present his budget.
Yeah, thank you, Tanvi, for having me. And I guess this is one of the debates which is a little sensible and I must say a little audible. So thank you and Faye for doing an excellent job out here. I believe that the government of the day, as by the government of the decade before that and the decade before that, are excelling actually in obfuscating issues. And I believe that, and what mystifies me is that every panelist, I mean, comes in and says respected this and respected that. In my job, my respect comes from my performance. It does not come with entitlement. So that, anyways, that is probably a different point. So I've been at pains to understand what the hell is really happening. But nevertheless, all right. Now, focusing on the issue, I believe that the Oxfam report, in fact, is an extremely critical point to make. It has actually tabled a systematic loot which has been happening since the last half a century, or probably a century, in fact. This is happening worldwide. But yes. That doesn't escape the fact that it's happening in India as well.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
That there has, thank you. And my point is that there has to be a landmark, a methodology being developed to actually look at equating that. So we are not talking about people who, if they are taxed, will have difficulty surviving. In fact, we are talking about taxing those people who wouldn't know even what to do with their money, even if we give 500 years for them to live.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Thank you so much, Vishnu, for calling and making that point a very valid point. And it is happening across the world. Here is the disparity for our viewers. And I'm quoting out of the Oxfam report now. It takes just 4 days for a CEO from one of the top five global fashion brands to earn what a Bangladeshi garment worker will earn in their entire lifetime. In the United States, it takes slightly over one working day for a CEO to earn what an ordinary worker will earn in one entire year. And this is how they go on to quote examples from across the country. For India, they have said 84% of Indians agree that the gap between the rich and the poor of the country is too large, and 73% want the Indian government to urgently reduce this gap with whatever method. The report goes on to suggest that you bring in, reintroduce the inheritance tax, you bring in a wealth tax, bring in long-term capital gains tax, to tax the wealthy of this country to try and narrow down this gap, which is also why we are raising this issue this evening. Mr. Gupta is calling us from Delhi. Good evening, Mr. Gupta. Where do you stand on this debate?
Hi, Tanvi. Thanks a lot for having me on your show. It's a wonderful debate that you're having. I have a different solution to this. What is happening is the tax regime looks at the whole taxation process in a very simplistic manner. That is, if an X person is earning more money, he has to pay more percentage of income and taxes. That results in the person trying to escape the tax regime and obviously park his money into somewhere else.
Yeah.
What we need to do, we have to encourage people to hire more, let's say, for example, low-income group people or poor people or even more better quality professionals, so that we can give tax rebate to, let's say, larger corporates. Larger you grow, you will get tax rebate on the more number of employment. We have a very huge population, a lot of capacity to deliver, but people lack employment because everybody is trying to hide their money somewhere else because of excessive taxation. Now, the tax rebates go to all these rich millionaires. I'm sure they'll be happy to employ a few hundred or thousand or maybe a lakh of other people. So that's how you can trickle down the benefits of a taxation down below. Number two, I have a simple point. No, where is my tax money going to? Where is the infrastructure coming up? All these, few days back, you had this issue on the fire.
Yes.
Right. So I need to have an online system with the government, at least is accountable to me as a taxpayer. Where is my tax money going to? What is the development coming up?
Okay.
Ward mein kya development ho raha hai? So there are two solutions I have.
Fair enough. Okay. Make it more transparent. If I am paying you X amount of tax, tell me where you're using that money. And the other one is incentivizing rather than pressurizing people to pay more tax. Mr. Guruswamy, you wanted to come in before we move on to the next question. Go ahead, please.
You know, our friend here who just spoke about tax rates being high. Matter of fact, the highest Indian tax bracket is lower than in America and in most of Europe.
Yes.
Only Russia has a flat 20% tax on all incomes.
Yes.
Everywhere else, at the higher income levels, you pay more tax. In the state of New York, for instance, you pay almost 45% tax. There's state income tax, there's a city tax. So you know, to say that there will be, and there's very little evasion there. Because punishment is severe. You get caught, you get go in.
Yes.
You know, even Al Capone was put in jail for tax evasion. So here we are, you know, you get fined 10,000 rupees for misdeclaration or a lack of rupees. You know, nothing happens, nothing scares people. And we're not scared of government. Who's scared of government? Government thinks it's got all the power, but nobody is scared of government. The electricity department can't collect his money, but nobody is scared. People don't pay taxes, nobody is scared.
Fair enough. In fact, I was going to raise that point.
Fear of government has gone. Respect of government has gone.
Yes, in fact, I was going to raise that point to Mr. Guruswamy that if you see globally, yes, the government does need to send out the message, it means business, so it does need to crack down on tax evaders. That logic cannot be a reason for you to not tax people, to say, oh, that will just increase tax evasion. If you see, United States has higher tax levels than us, even if we count the highest super rich plus surcharge tax slab that we have right now in most of Europe, it's higher than us, like you pointed out very correctly. Let me go on to a second question, which is to say, is the tax structure then designed in such a way that
I'm debunking the notion the taxes are high.
Go ahead, sir. Finish your point. Yes.
Yeah, I'm debunking the notion that taxes are high. There is a case for increased taxation, and you should do it. Otherwise, you know, you would have out of control inequality, which will reach to social disorder. You can't keep people down by force. And so you need to do something. You need to give people something. Not in the long term or in the medium, but in the now term. Start tomorrow and announce schemes of building, announce schemes for money transfer to people who have, you know, for instance, why don't we have a universal income transfer? It's a good thing. It puts money into the hands of people. A 10-acre farmer today, earns less money than a chaprasi in the tehsil office, whose base salary is 40,000 rupees. And the reason why your taxpayers have gone up is because of pay commission, people have gone into higher tax brackets. So, you know, you need to get more order into society and more equality. And, you know, some of the corporate salaries are out of control. I can see a ratio of 1 to 100.
Hmm.
But I can't understand a ratio of 1 to 10,000 or 1 to 500. So you need to peg ratios and say, you know, good corporate behavior means that, you know, reducing your ratios, you know, maybe bring it to 60, 70, 50. So these are targets you need to look into.
Okay, Mr. Gopal Agarwal wants to respond to you.
This glorious to be rich.
Can I say now? The issue is that there is every case that the government resources should increase. And there is every case that this increased resources should go to the people who are needy, those who need help, support from the government. There is no denial of this fact. But I have quoted one figure that under GST, 4,000 firms only, top 4,000 firms are paying 80% of GST tax. At the same time, by the composition scheme, 95% of the population of small and medium sectors are out, traders, commerce activities are out of the GST network. The government is already in a structure where 80% of the tax, more than 80% is collected from less than 10% of people. That structure is already there. I want to tell you is that inefficiency in distribution mechanism, channels of the government, and non-compliance and tax evasion in the whole system cannot be passed on to selected few by taxing them higher. Government has to remove the inefficiency in tax compliances. It has to control tax evasion. It has to increase efficiency in its delivery mechanism. That is the prime way through which more tax compliance can come out, more resources can be generated, and there has to be a better targeted distribution of government schemes. This is the important issue that we should consider. And this is the only way so that we can move ahead. Second thing I want to tell you is that this agriculture income is under the constitution, cannot be taxed by the central government or the state government. Constitution does not allow. So there is no question of taxing agriculture income. But there is every case that non-agriculture income, those who are manipulating into and showing it as a part of agriculture income, they have to be controlled and checked. And that the government is already doing. Several lakh people who were showing more than 1 crore of agriculture income and not paying taxes, they have been issued notices.
But you know,
and under the GST,
great,
the demonetization, government has got access to large data, big data. That is being analyzed at the government
okay,
level.
Okay, I'm not even questioning that. I don't even want to go there.
Caught.
Yes,
so
okay.
Let me finish.
No, can I go back to the agricultural point? Okay, you finish then.
At present, we don't see... Yes. No, at present, we don't see any point of view in increasing tax rate. Government inefficiency and non-compliances from the part of people should not be put burden on people who are compliant. So I don't think ki there is any case with regard to increasing tax structure, though there is an issue for equality of income.
Yes.
The government is already tackling it through several other issues.
Okay.
Corruption, inefficiency,
okay. So
non-compliances,
yes.
We cannot... At the
I will come back to you on that point and ask you in the third part of the debate, Mr. Agarwal, of what other methods will be used to plug in these leakages and widen the tax base. But explain to me why you believe that something which is there as a law in the 1950s should continue in 2019 as well. Why? Explain to me why you think that the agricultural income should not be taxed. At least there are almost 3,000 cases where the income is more than 1 crore rupees and we are still not taxing it. Do you think that makes sense, Mr. Agarwal?
I answered it, but again I'll repeat is that those people who are disclosing their other income sources from other income into agriculture income and manipulating the law, there is every case to catch them.
I agree with you. Of course you should. I think it goes beyond that. Okay. I think it goes beyond that. I think it also goes down to those super rich farmers who are actually getting this money from their agricultural income, but now should probably start contributing towards the growth of the country, because not everybody is dying under the debt that you're rushing to wave off. Mr. Mohan Guruswamy wanted to come in. Yes, Mr. Guruswamy.
Let me intervene here.
No, if somebody is manipulating the law, misusing the law, and showing
Gopal, just listen, Gopal.
Agriculture income, that's a different issue. You cannot equate it with taxing agriculture income.
All right. Now let Mr. Guruswamy make his argument. Then you can respond to that.
83% of farmers are small or marginal. 83%. The number of farmers who have holdings of 10 to 15 acres are a very slim margin. And even on 10 acres, you don't get that kind of income. The farmers you see who have become rich are the farmers who have sold their lands because of growing urbanization. You know, all the Gurgaon lands and the Bhiwadi lands, all over the country you're seeing this expansion. Hmm. And those farmers have got rich, so you think that is agriculture income. They pass it off as agriculture income and they evade the tax. But I think Gopal is right. You got to catch the people who use this as a... And he should know best. He's an auditor. He's a chartered accountant. Hmm. His whole discipline is how to cut taxes down. And so, you know, we all know all the loopholes are, what the exemptions are.
Yeah.
I think you've got to knock some of those exemptions out, the tax, you know, hives you've created, you've got to knock them out. And there are a lot of things you can do by just simplifying the tax system. Don't give exemptions. Be very rigid with the exemptions. You give the exemptions only if they invest in R&D. Otherwise, you know, stop it. But they take exemptions everywhere and, you know, they hide money. Individuals hide money, individuals take exemptions. Now, I heard a chief minister actually say some time ago that he earns 10 crores per acre. And we've seen the returns, the kind of money shown for agro income. If you can grow that kind of wealth, this whole country would become rich.
Yeah. Okay, I'm running out of time.
Agriculture is a struggling business. Anyway, at best of time.
Well, just a small comment.
Yes, yes, Mr. Agarwal.
Ahead. I'm sorry.
I agree with Mr. Guruswamy when he says that there is every case for simplification of tax laws Over the years, we have made the tax law very complicated with exemptions, revenue foregone. So many complications have come into corporate taxes and individual taxes with incentives, incentivizing geographical areas to activities.
Well, you know, I'm sorry, I'll have to interrupt you there, Mr. Agarwal, because we'll have that conversation another day for sure. In the coming days, we are going to focus on how do we simplify this entire regime as well. But I have a very small question for you before I wind this up. You are talking about cleaning up and you're talking about cracking down on tax evaders and bringing more people under the tax net. Is there a number you can give me? Less than 2% of our Indians today pay tax to the government. What is your target?
Target is that the government has sent notice to around 18 lakh people who have deposited into the bank account under demonetization more than their known source of income. They have been sent notices to explain from where this money comes and if their source of income is not commensurate with the amount they have deposited, they will definitely take legal action will be taken against them. Around 4 lakh companies who were found to act under PMLA, under the demonetization, used multiple bank accounts to deposit large sums and transfer money through PMLA.
And a higher number of individual accounts that you, Mr. Agarwal, that you're giving me, and we hope that those notices actually end up in some kind of strict action against these tax evaders. But the point is, we're talking about a country with 125 crore. Now, all of them may not necessarily be in the age group of paying taxes. But definitely 1.9 crore or 2 crore is not the figure that we have to be looking at. So by all means, the government should go ahead and chase those who refuse to give what is their duty towards nation building in terms of taxes. And if they're hiding their money, go after them. But tonight, we also want to ask the countrymen and ask the government to think about this. Think about the fact that there's a widening gap, the disparity between the poor and the rich. It's a very simple concept. If people know that the inheritance tax will take away 50% of the property, they will not probably hoard so much. That they will probably give away more in charity in their own lifetime. The concept of inheritance tax comes from there. Similarly, the concept of super rich tax has a larger morality towards it. The haves and the haves not have to work together to build a country. And that is what we are talking about tonight. Something to think about. We will continue this debate. Over the next few days, we'll also bring up more issues that will be the key focus in this budget. Issues that you want us to highlight, please do write in to us. I will have to thank my panelists, Mr. Guruswamy. Thank you so much for joining us. Gopal Agarwal, good to have you with us. Thank you for joining. Good night, viewers.